Hello, my name is Sharon Hughes from BASF, and today I'd like to do a presentation on Soolantra. This is a technical training guide on Soolantra, which is BASF's new rodenticide bait. Thank you. The presentation outline will consist of information on each of the 10 below. We have the product highlights, what Soolantra actually is, its physical and chemical properties, and how it actually works. The rodents that are on the label that we can control with Soolantra, and how we recommend it to be used. Its status against anticoagulant resistant rats and mice, its toxicological and its environmental profile, safety measures and global testimonials. Throughout this presentation, there are key features and benefits of Soolantra, and all the information that we will present is to highlight these four key features and benefits. So what are they? 7 days. It's possible in certain circumstances to get rodent-free infestations within as few as 7 days. And this is because of the unique mode of action of the active cholecalciferol that's in Soolantra, and the highly palatable bait matrix. So it's a combination of those two. They partner together. And this enables Soolantra to achieve complete control of even large infestations within as few as 7 days. It stops the waste of resources. So what do we mean by that? Because of the unique stop feeding effect, it prevents rodents from over-consuming, so they won't have multiple lethal doses inside. So therefore, the end user's not wasting bait with kind of feeding rats and mice that have already eaten their lethal dose. So therefore saving time and money. Balancing performance and environmental impact. So the active substance, cholecalciferol, it's neither persistent in the environment nor bioaccumulative, and is also readily metabolized by rodents. So there's that balance. And then the final one is breaks the cycle of resistance. So what we mean by that it controls all rodents that are resistant to anticoagulants. And the development of resistance to the active cholecalciferol is considered to be highly unlikely. So after that brief introduction to our key features and benefits, let's go to talk about Soolantra. So what about the product overview? Well, it's a ready-to-use rodent bait with high performance for professional use only. The active ingredient, as I've mentioned, is cholecalciferol, and the key to this is that it's not an anticoagulant. And this cholecalciferol is in at 750 parts per million, or 0.075%. It's a soft bait formulation, so it's not hard wax block-like. It's a soft bait, like a pasta. And it's pale green in colour. It's registered for both rats and mice in both rural and urban environments. And it's securable. You see in the slides to come that it has a hole in the middle, so there's no other soft block bait that actually has a hole to make securing it on wires and rods far more easily. It has a human taste deterrent and a warning dye. And obviously it's efficacious in both lab and field trials, and it's as efficacious as an anticoagulant bait. But we can get quicker control, and I can come on to that soon. And the thing is about this, there's no pre-baiting required. Historically with cholecalciferol baits, pre-baiting was required, but we don't require that for this. The ingredients in cilantro, 99% of them are human food grade ingredients. So this is what makes it so attractive. So it's not just the fact that they are human food grade ingredients, but also the combination of these. So getting the right balance. So it was very carefully formulated. It contains vegetable oil as the binder. So there's no pork fat as many or in many other pastas and soft blocks. And the wrapper, if you like, round this cilantro is a permeable, is a film that's flavour permeable. So it has small holes dotted in them so that that allows this natural odour of this 99% ingredients out. And then also there's an added odour that's been placed in it that it's for rodents. So neither you or I can smell it. It's there a level for rodents. So this makes it appealing. The rodents want to investigate and want to taste it. And this permeable film, that's far more suitable to a cholecalciferol bait than is a paper. That's why we had this film, this like plastic-like film, because it was more suited to our formulation. We have a shelf life of 3 years, and then as I'll demonstrate further on in this PowerPoint, we have stability at extremely high and low temperatures, and we have done studies to show that we have a degree of resistance to mold. And then also we have a technology in it called Fortec. So those of you who have know Cerexa Fortec, Cerexa Gold, you'll know about these Fortec grains. So it's just little specks of an alternative, like in cilantro it's little black seeds, so it's an alternative texture and taste that's in there, and it's just there to provide interest in for the rodent, another thing to keep them interested, another texture, another taste. Okay. In a few slides in this presentation, we'll talk about palatability. And what do we mean by that? So these are studies that were done in the laboratory. And what we do, we take the test bait, which is cilantro, and we take a control. And the control could be, for example, in the top photograph, a standard laboratory diet. So that's a laboratory diet that the animals are fed on all their life. So it's palatable, it's nutritious, it's well balanced. And then we just compare how much of each they eat. Or the control could be a competitor bait, like in the picture below. Or it could be if we look at the examples on the left-hand side to the photographs, it could be piglet feed, silage, and like we say, a competitor bait. So we can test our bait, cilantro, with a number of things. And throughout this presentation, you'll see reference to studies that were done in this choice feeding way. And when we test cilantro against a competitor, it's quite often called a head-to-head. And what do the results of this palatability actually mean? So if we just measure the amounts of each that they eat, and if they eat the same amount of both, that's 50% of each, 50% of the other, we can see that the palatability ratio is then 1. If they eat twice as much cilantro as whatever we're offering as the control, then the palatability ratio is 2. Most anticoagulant baits have a palatability of between 0.5 and 1.5, with 1 been kind of a good average and 2 been an excellent palatability. And it's normally soft blocks that have it nearer to the 1.5 to 2. When we first started on looking and developing and formulating this cholecalciferol bait, we had to look at the competitor baits that actually contain cholecalciferol. Why weren't they as successful? And remember this palatability ratio of 1, where they eat 50% of the test bait, so in our case cilantro, and 50% of the control diet. Well, we looked at, like I say, the competitor baits and tested them against males and females. So males in the dark green, females the light green. And we can see, so there's the results of 6 studies here. And we can see if we look at the, starting with the cholecalciferol competitor wax block baits, that's a wax block. And the palatability here in both males and females was just below 1, about 0.6, 0.7. And we also then looked at a cholecalciferol competitor pellet. And again, the palatability did not come up to the 1 mark in either males or females. And then once we'd formulated cilantro, we wanted to raise the benchmark. We wanted to make it as palatable as we could. And we spent many years on this. And if we look at the palatability in males and females, we can see that in our laboratory studies, we have a palatability of around 4.5 for males and around 6 for females. So you can see that aim to raise the bar. We made it. And this is really important. If you remember this slide, when we come to talk about the mode of action later, do you remember I said that the success of this bait is the combination of the bait matrix and the mode of action? So this is our bait matrix with this level of palatability. And here I just want to show you a video. We had cilantro on the right hand side and a competitor soft block on the left. And here you can see that the rats, they made no attempt to eat the competitor. They were straight in for the cilantro. And this is how they eat it. They make a hole at the top and then they take the cilantro from inside. So quite often then, when you go back after one or two days, the empty sachets are actually just left on the rod. So the next set of tests that we did were these head-to-heads that I mentioned before. So we took cilantro and a competitor bait, and each rat was offered the choice. You can have both of these, you can decide to eat one, to eat the other, to eat a bit of both. And then we measured the results, and here we can see. So this is the results of three studies. The pale green is how much competitor bait that the rats ate on day one. And the green is how much cilantro. And I'll come round to why we only record or present the data from day one later on when I talk about mode of action. So here we have the first study is cilantro against a 50 ppm bromodiolone bait. And we can see that the average amount of the bromodiolone bait was about 4 grams and cilantro about 16. So that's about 4 times more palatable. Then the next study was cilantro against a difethylone bait. And we can see that the cilantro is about 8 times more palatable. So about 8 times more cilantro eaten than the difethylone bait. And then the final one was cilantro against a kumatetralol bait. And here we can see we're almost 12, 13 times more palatable. So that's the results of our head-to-head. So comparing cilantro with competitor blocks and pastes in a side-by-side or a head-to-head choice test. But while we were really excited about the results in the laboratory, when the end user goes to place Cilantra in the environment, in the infestation, it's not competitor baits they have to worry about. It's the competitor food that's already in that site. So we went to a farm and we took maize silage from the farm and we brought it back to the laboratory. And then we went to a farm and we took piglet feed and we brought that back to the laboratory. And we did two studies. Again, if you remember our choice feeding, so in for these two studies, the first one, the rats could have a choice of Cilantra or maize silage. And here we can see the amount of Cilantra eaten on this first day was 13, just over 13 times more Cilantra was eaten than the maize silage. The second study was on different rats now and looking at the choice they had between Cilantra and piglet feed. They could eat one, they could eat the other, or they could eat both. And we can see that Cilantra was over four times more palatable. So over four times more Cilantra was eaten compared to the piglet feed. So it far outperformed the alternative feed that an end user would find in a rural environment. So what all this data gave us was confidence now that when we take Cilantra into an actual infestation, that we're expecting good results. But what then? What about in the urban environment where there's no maize silage and piglet feed? So we bought burgers and we tested Cilantra against burger, but just the meat part, just the pate part, not the vegetables or the bun, because we wanted to have the worst case. So it's the meat, the actual burger that's full of the fat and protein that the rodent needs and likes. So we can look at the graph and we can see again the average amount of take from our different set of rats now eaten on day one, and we can see that it was just over 60, almost 70 grams for the Cilantra, and the burger was about 50 grams. So slightly more Cilantra was eaten than the beef burger. So we were really pleased with that. If we'd have come out even or even slightly better, we'd have been really pleased. But to come out slightly ahead, when Cilantra is tested against a really palatable alternative food source that's in an urban environment, we were really happy. So now, again, both in urban and in rural environments, we were confident that when we take this bait to field trial, that we should get really good results. So far, all the results I've shown have been brown rats, Norway rats, Rattus norvegicus. So I just want to show this clip now of a laboratory study done on semi-wild black rats. So again, they have this choice. They can have cilantro or they can eat. In this case, it was this laboratory diet, just a normal diet that they fed on all their lives. And I'll show you the video clip, but if you just look at the results first on the left-hand side, we can see that on the first day, they ate about 5-6 times more cilantro than they did the control diet. And on the second day, and we'll come on to this later, although they ate twice as much cilantro as the control diet, we can see that massive drop in the amount of both that's eaten. And this is a stop feeding effect, which if you just bear in mind, we'll come to that later, but this is a good example of that. And I'll play the video. So we can see here, there's really almost no attempt to even investigate or eat from their control diet, even though it's the diet they've been feeding on all their lives. So 1, 2, 3, 4 rats all eating the cilantro. So now I want to take you through one of the first studies we did in a field trial. And this was, we went to an infestation in a rural environment, and each bait point had both cilantro and a key competitor bait. And we used covered and protected bait points. It was done in the UK. And that's how we lay out our bait points. There was approximately 120 Rattus norvegicus, so brown rats, on this infestation. And for each day, we measured the amount of cilantro and the amount of the competitor bait. It was a 50 parts per million bromodiolone competitor bait. We measured the amount of each that was eaten. And we can see the results after 4 days. And each of the day we can see significantly more cilantro was eaten throughout this, during this infestation. And all in all, it was over a 5-fold difference between the amount of cilantro and the amount of key competitor bait that was eaten. So So again, we're building our confidence, we're building our awareness of the cilantro story. So the next one of our topics that I want to cover is physical and chemical properties. So to demonstrate that cilantro would be suitable in extreme temperatures, we placed it in the freezer at minus 18 degrees C for a week and then undertaken a palatability test on it, this choice feeding. And there was no significant difference in palatability for pre and post a week in the freezer. And then the second study we did was at 77 degrees C. So this was to mimic extreme heat in the back of the boot of a pest controller's van in the blazing heat in maybe southern Spain, something like that. So again, we did this after one day and there was no seepage of any oil, or there was no melting of the cholecalciferol. But after 5 hours, many of the wax blocks melted and fell off the rod that we were securing them to, or they were seeping wax onto the surface. This obviously didn't happen with cilantro because the binding is done by oil, it's not done by wax. So cilantro is a global product and it's on sale now in many countries already. And they've been asking for different conditions for cilantro to be tested in different conditions. So we undertook some studies and we tested them. So we subject the cilantro to different conditions and then do a laboratory test. So on the left-hand side, we have ambient. So it's just our normal cilantro conditions, and there's the palatability ratio, how it performs against laboratory diet. And we have one of around just under 5. And then we have the minus 18 degrees C, and there was the palatability. Still 3.5. So those two, when you take individual variations, they're not different. We did one at 90% relative humidity and 37 degrees C, because in some countries it's not so much heat, it's humidity, especially when we look at countries in around Asia, they're concerned more about humidity. And then we did one outside in a bait box. So this is in a bait box in Germany through December, and temperatures differed from minus 2 to 14 degrees C with humidity from 72 to 91. And so this was for a week, it rained for 6 of those days. So quite damp, quite humid, coldish conditions. But throughout that, after this, cilantro still performed. We still got extremely high palatability ratio. And when we statistically analyse the results from each of these four studies, there's no difference in the results. So now we come on to mode of action. Cholecalciferol, the active substance in Soolantra, it's naturally occurring in tissues and in the blood of animals, and it's under very tight metabolic control, and we'll come on to why that is. And it's a key regulator of calcium in the blood, so it's really important to make in balancing our calcium levels in the blood. And we make it by sun, by the effects of sun on our skin. And if we have too much cholecalciferol, it results in something called hypercalcemia. So hyper just means too much, and calcemia in the blood. And that's the mode of action of cholecalciferol. The main mode of action is hypercalcemia. So when we have these toxic doses of cholecalciferol, what happens? So we need cholecalciferol for healthy teeth and bones. But when we have too much, when we have this toxic dose, it has the reverse effect. The cholecalciferol is taken out from the bones, if you like, and then it's circulated around in the blood. We get absorption increasing from the small intestines, and excretion is reduced from the kidneys. So we have more in the blood and more keeps being absorbed, but the excretion is being slowed right down. So we have a buildup of calcium in the blood. And as this calcium buildup comes in the blood, the body wants to get rid. It wants to deposit. So it deposits this calcium in soft tissues and organs and vessels. So things like the heart, the kidney, the liver, the lung, the stomach, that's where these calcium stones get deposited. And the first that we are aware as the end user of a rodent bait that contains cholecalciferol is this loss of appetite that I've mentioned a few times. So loss of appetite. This results in a stop feeding effect. And this stop feeding effect happens 24 hours, just after 24 hours after they've eaten a lethal dose. So this stop feeding effect has multiple implications. So they stop feeding on cilantro, so you don't get this multiple doses being eaten. They also stop feeding on the alternative food source that's there. And then because they don't feel like eating, they don't move around and forage as much. Because if you don't want to eat, that's your main reason for leaving your nest, is to go out and forage for food. And also, about this time as well, it starts having an impact on how they move, their mobility. So therefore, after the 24 hours, they're not moving, they're not eating cilantro, they're not eating the alternative food, they're not damaging, they're not contaminating. So it's a massive quick result for the end user and for the customer. So this is a nice infographic to just summarise what we've said. So we have cholecalciferol increases calcium in the blood. We have this stop feeding effect after 24 hours. And then we have death 2 to 5 days after they've eaten their lethal dose, that we have death from hypercalcemia. So the next topic is the rodents that are actually controlled. What's on the label of our cilantro bait? So the three species are the house mice, Mus musculus, the brown or the Norway rat, Rattus norvegicus, and the black or the roof rat, Rattus rattus. And we have, these are the three on the label, and we can get quick and effective control, including any of these that are actually resistant to anticoagulants. And we have data that we've controlled these three species, any that are also with neophobic behaviour. So to control each of our three species, how much cilantro do they each need to take to ingest? Well, if we start by, there's three pies, if you like, and each one is for one of the three species. So if we start with the first one on the left, so a 250 gram brown rat, they're going to eat about 25 grams of food a day. So that's that circle, that's the 25 gram pie, if you like. And the LD50, so the lethal dose for a 50% chance of dying or to kill 50% of an infestation, each would have to eat 13.7 grams for our 250 gram rat. And 13.7 grams is approximately 55% of their daily food intake. So we'd need a palatability ratio in their field of just over one. And remember, our palatability ratios are between 4 and 6 for males to females. So you can see why we would, that's really possible for the brown rat to have a lethal dose in a day, to eat, to want to eat. And this is where palatability comes in, a lethal dose in a day. And what we've found in the field is actually it's more potent in the field than the laboratory. And if you think, if they stop feeding after 24 hours and are just in their burrows or nests and they're not moving and they're not eating with this hypercalcemia, then they're more subjective to the cold and the harsh conditions. So you can see why this type of bait would be more potent out there in a true environment than in the laboratory. If we now go to the next pie and we look at 150 gram black rat, and their daily food consumption is about 15 grams. So again, 10% of their body weight. And that's their pie. And the LD50 for our 150 gram black rat is approximately, well, it is 8.6 grams. So that's 57% of their daily food intake. And again, with our palatability ratio of 4, we can see how we could easily achieve that, just over half of the food needs to be cilantro. And then we get to the house mice. So our 25 gram house mouse, they're going to eat about 5 grams, so about 25% of their body weight, 20 to 25% of their body weight a day. So of the pie, now if we look under that, this LD50 for the house mouse, 25 grams, is 1.4 grams of cilantro. So that's only 28% of the daily food take. So we can now see that for each of these three target species, for them to eat a lethal dose in the 24 hours before any stop feeding, we can see why we really needed to have our cilantro as palatable as possible. And that's what we have achieved. So one of the key benefits for cilantro is the speed of action. So remember, it takes just after 24 hours, we have the first wave of the infestation, the first hierarchical stop feeding. And that's why it's possible, and I'll explain a bit more, to have it control of the infestation within as few as 7 days, which is quicker than the 14 to 28 days that are normally achieved with anticoagulants, with the average being 21 days. This slide demonstrates this mode of action, this quick time to death. If we look at the two lines, the first line in the green, that's the results of 50 laboratory rats, brown rats, that were fed Soolantra. And we looked at how long they take to die. And we can see that obviously on day one we have, so there we have no deaths. They start dying. We have some on day two, some on day three, and then by day four they were all dead. So that's the kind of the curve that we have for Soolantra. And we did a similar study then. We took 50 rats and we fed them a second generation anticoagulant and looked at the times to death for them. And we got a very, very typical anticoagulant curve. A very few deaths at 3 days, most of the deaths between day four, five and six, and then tailing off so that they were all dead by day 10. And what we can see here, that while both baits affected 100% mortality, we've concertinaed, we've reduced the actual time to death. So for Soolantra, the mean, the average time to death was 2.8 days. And for the anticoagulant, it was 5.7 days. For the Soolantra, we had 100% mortality after day three. For the anticoagulant, it was day nine. So you can see this pushing together of the how quickly they all die to get a faster control. So far we've talked mainly about brown rats and some about black rats. So this is the studies to show in house mice. Remember the species on the label. So we had pen trials, and what these are, it's an arena where the mice live and breed as normal. So it's a colony of males, females, young and old. And then we offer them in a choice feeding the diet they've been feeding on all their life, or in this case, Soolantra. And this is the results of three separate studies. And we had different strains, and these were wild-derived mice. So we the first two tests were on wild-derived, and they were anticoagulant susceptible. So they had the same susceptibility to the anticoagulants. There was no resistance. The third study we did was again on wild derived, and these mice, they were bromodialone resistant. And then the next column, if we look, that just says the number of mice that there were. And obviously it's an odd number because it's a living breeding colony. We don't know how many are there until at the very end when we're looking at how many have actually died. If we look at this palatability, this day one palatability, we can see that for the first study, the palatability ratio was almost 54, so really high palatability. The second study, it was 16, and the third study, it was just under 25. So these mice found this really, really palatable. And then lastly, if we look at mortality, so deaths, we can see for each of the three studies, we had 100% mortality by day five in one, by day five in the second, and by day five in the third. So we can see in house mice, Soolantra is very palatable and efficacious against both susceptible, so that's anticoagulant susceptible, and anticoagulant resistant mice. So really important study for us. The majority of the data that we've shown so far has been laboratory studies and how we developed and how we learnt about how palatable and how effective Soolantra was. So now I want to show you the results of some field trial studies. And this is how we demonstrate that the Soolantra or any bait that we choose to send to field trial, how we know that it's working. And we only do that by monitoring the infestation either end before and after the Soolantra treatment. So this is the protocol that we have, and we have this protocol for any bait, like I say. So we start with a pre-census. So that's in another term for that is a pre-baiting monitoring. We're just monitoring the infestation. How many rats are there or mice? How were they moving? Where are they eating? So that's what we do for that. And then we have what's called a pre-baiting lag period. And the purpose of that is so that there is never any question that this pre-monitoring was actually encouraging or enticing in any way the rats or mice to feed on the Soolantra. So we have this lag period, and that's usually 10 days. Then we have the baiting period, which for cilantro, we have many, many trials where that's only 7 days. Then we have, when we finish baiting, we then have another lag period that's normally 4 to 7 days. And the purpose of this is to allow any of the last rats or mice to die. And then we then have the post-census monitoring. So the post-treatment monitoring. So now we can, after we've done all of that, we can look then at the activity and the recordings we had pre-census, and the activity and recordings we had post-census, and look at the difference. And from those two values, we can then calculate the percentage of control that we actually have. So this is an example of a house mouse field study, and this was undertaken in London at a hotel, so an urban infestation. And the challenges that we faced at this site was that the mice were not behaving typically, so they were neophobic mice. They were frightened of new things, so which is more a behaviour we associate with rats. So they wouldn't go into bait boxes, they were cautious about walking over tracking patches. So we had this problem, and also then obviously there's all the alternative food, highly palatable alternative food. So if we look at the pre-census, so what is the pre-census? So we use two methods. The first is a diet one. So we use some blank diet. So I use wheat. We use wheat for these trials, but there are other things that you could use as this monitoring, this pre-census monitoring. And for us, we use this so that we can have an idea of the infestations, and also to collect data to show customers and users that Solantra is actually working. Regulators, we need to prove it, and this is how we do it, as I said. So the grey bars at the top graph are how much of the census diet was eaten each day for the 4 days. Remember our pre-census monitoring. And we can see that it goes up from 10 grams to 20 to 30. So this increase is as the mice become more and more accustomed to the tray that we used for the census diet. So this again shows that the neophobia, but the historic use by the pest controller involved in this site, he told us that this was the issue. And then we have the lag period, so we're on the top graph, and then we go into baiting with Solantra. So the first day's take, we normally expect that to be really high, and here you can see it's approximately 10 grams. So very, very much like the first day of the pre-census. But then the second day, we go right up to 45 grams. And then we come down as we get control, and we can see now that we've got control after 15 days baiting. After that, we get no more take recorded. And then we have the lag, and then the post-census monitoring. And then for 4 days, we get none of our monitoring diet taken. So we could say that after 15 days of baiting with Solantra at this really problematic site with the house mice, that we have control. But that's only one way. What if the mice were still there, but for some reason not feeding? So we have a second method, and for this we use tracking. So there are tracking patches out there, there are different tracking mediums, and where possible, I use just sand. So that's the common thing, but there are things that you can use. And we just then score, so we put a patch down, maybe 100 millimetres by 100 millimetres, and then just score that. Are there no tracks, so zero. Is the patch completely covered in tracks, mouse tracks, then it's a 4, and just your own scale. And it's just a look-see to give an idea. And we can see that in the pre-census, we have this tracking score going up, down, and it gives us an idea. And then we have the lag period. And then what happens with this while we're baiting with Solantra? So we can see for the first 2 days that this tracking score is more or less the same, and the same as it was for the pre-census. Then on days 3 to 8, so that's a summary really of like approximately five days take, it's still the same. But then the time we get to day 9, the tracking score is really reduced. Days 6 to 17, we're down to no take, no score. And then we have the lag period, because this is all done at the same time as we're doing the pre-census. And then we go in with the tracking score, looking at the footprints, the paw prints, post-census, and we get 0 or almost 0. So with those two methods, we can say that after 17 days of baiting, we have 98 to 100% control. Now, the other thing we do is the pre-census diet take. It gives us an idea of the size of the infestation. And we normally say that 2.5 grams of take per mouse per day. So every 2.5 grams each day equals one mouse. And that gives us a rough idea. It's not an exact science, but it means we've not got 2, we've not got 200, we've not got 50. We've got this to about 20 mice. And the pre-census take, the pre-monitoring take, that might have been higher if it wasn't for this neophobia. So we can see there now we've got an excellent result in a very difficult site where they were struggling to get control. The next field trial that I want to go through is one that was undertaken in France on like a free range hen house or rural environment. And these were against anticoagulant resistant brown rats. And we used a bait box, obviously. So a lot of countries have to use bait boxes. So I want to focus on studies in bait boxes as well. And what we have is exactly the same thing as you've just seen. We did exactly the same method, but if you look at the top graph, look how long it's taken these rats before they were comfortable with the pre-census. Now, remember in mind, the pre-census is something, again, it was wheat, so it's something that these rats are used to seeing around this free-range hen house. And it goes, you can see maybe from 250 grams take on day one, all the way up to 2.5 kilos. So over 11 days, there was a tenfold increase in the daily take. And that was just a neophobic, which we know rats are, so frightened of new things, a neophobic response to the bait boxes. But once we're happy that the rats were comfortable with the bait boxes, then we baited with cilantro. So we had the lag period, so we couldn't be, we'd dissociate the presensus and the baiting, and then we bait with cilantro. And we can see here the same pattern as before. We have the daily takes. I mean, for cilantro, you don't have to visit every day, but we do this to gather data so we can see exactly what's happening. And we can see that the last take was recorded on day 9 to 11. And then the graph underneath, exactly the same, we can see tracking score. So after day 3, we start, the tracking score drops, significantly drops. So after 3 days, we have a massive drop in tracking score. And then the last recorded track score was on day 12, with day 13 and 14 being zero. And if we look at the post-census, we can see on both of them, we have zero recordings. So there's no post-census diet take and no post-census tracking. So we have 100% control with 13 days of baiting, brown rats in a poultry, so high competitor food. The rats were anticoagulant resistant and they were neophobic to the bait boxes that were first put in place. So a very challenging trial site. And using this pre-census as the diet take as an indication, there was approximately 230 rats there. The next slide, again, bait boxes, is brown rat, now it's urban. So this is in a series of houses connected, so like terraced, that were converted into student flats. So the challenge of the site, there was a high amount of human rubbish and fast food being thrown on the floors, the bins that were supposed to collect the rubbish were overflowing. And also to add to this issue, there was broken drains at the front of the house. So again, we have exactly the same thing, the pre-census, and then we go in with the lag period. Then green bar is the first day of the cilantro take. Then days 2 to 3, so that's a combination of 2 days take. So we can see this massive reduction, and this is the more typical that we see. Do you remember this control within 7 days? Day 4 to 6, it was minimal take, and then day 7 to 8, nothing. Then the lag period and no census, no monitoring diet take after. And then to look at the tracking scores, we have this high, then we dipped, and then we went back up again to mimic the census take. And then the tracking score throughout the Soolantra baiting period, we can see from day 1 to day 2 to 3, given that that value is 2 days take, we had a significant drop. Then we go to day 4 to 6, and again another significant drop. And the last tracking score was recorded on days 7 to 8. So after that, no more scores. And again, with the post-census, no tracking score recorded. So we had 100% control with our, after 6 days of baiting, because on day 8 days of baiting, we had 100% control, and we had approximately 30 rats. So we have numerous data obtained globally on field trial studies that we've collected. So this is just a summary. Do you remember I said that we control is possible within 7 days, and that's a key feature and benefit? So here are each of the three species, the number of trials that we've looked at, and then the next column is the mean, the average days of baiting with the range. So we have for house mice, the average is 11.3. and the range is 7 to 21. For brown rats, the average is 10.5, and the range is 6 to 23. And for black rats, the average is 6.4, and the range 5 to 10. And then for each species, the number of trials that were actually were baited for 7 days of or less. So for house mice, it was 2, so that's 50%. For brown rats, it was 10, so that's about 67%. And for black rats, it was 4 out of 5, so about 80%. And for each of these that had extended baiting periods, there were issues. And that's what happens, isn't it, with pest control? There will be issues. There might be problems with behaviour. There might be access. There might be immigration. So for each of these, they were not typical sites. If there is such a thing, they all brought their problems. And we can see the mean level of control achieved. So that's the summary of our slide. So when we say control is possible within 7 days on not all trials, but it may be on a lot of trials, that goal is can be achieved. Once we were, had all our data, we wanted to show how Soolantra performs to end users, to key customers. So this is a result of a trial that we did in the UK where Nordic customers were invited. And we can see here how it was on a rural farm, obviously, dairy arable, and we can see the people involved and a brief outline of what the farm looked like in photographs. It wasn't the best kept, but this is a typical farm in the UK. In the centre, you can see the tracking patches and how we'd score them. Maybe there's an example of paw prints, footprints. And then at the top, we can see we've remove the cover off this bait to show that originally on that tray there were 7 cilantro blocks, and we can see now there's only 2. So they were wired onto the block, and then the tray was then covered to make it covered and protected. That's how this trial was undertaken, and there's our tracking patch which we then score. So that's the setup when we don't have to use bait boxes. This trial, these are the results. So again, we have the pre-sensors we only did for 3 days. Then we have the cilantro take, high on day 1. We had it significantly reduced on day 2 as we have this stop feeding effect, 3 to 4 again, and then that was it. Small take on day 5, next to nothing then after that, nothing day 6, day 7, and no hardly any, just small amount post-census there. The tracking score, remember how we did that, and we can see now post-census just a small amount of take of tracking score. So we had approximately 230 rats at this customer trial, and the score on the control was 94% to 98% control achieved with 7 days of baiting. The challenges, as you can imagine, there was silage, concentrated cattle nuts, there was barley, there'd been no control for a year, there was lots of harborages. So in this difficult site, we had 100% control with 7 days of bait. Sorry, 94 to 98% control with 7 days of bait. So having covered all of the trials and that, and with the rodents that are on the label, now we come to use recommendations. So this slide now shows what the label would say. So for house mice, domestic, commercial and rural, it's 1 to 2 blocks. That's 20 grams to 40 grams. Because remember from the beginning, each cilantro block weighs 20 grams. And it's every 1 to 2 metres. For black or brown rats in domestic, commercial and rural, it's 100 grams to 140 grams. So 5 to 7 blocks every 5 to 10 metres. And this 1 to 2 metres for mice and 5 to 10 metres for rats, it's the same that's on, say, the Storm or the Storm Ultra label. You don't have to bait any differently. And the same that is on our Sirexa labels. And obviously, where there's bait should be placed where there's evidence of rat and mouse activity, and denser, so nearer the 5 meters where the activity is greatest. So that's just standard baiting practice. So we're not, it's nothing different than what pest controllers and end users are used to. This is an infographic to demonstrate the baiting regime for cilantro in rats. So we have 7-2-7. So 7 blocks is the maximum you should be placing down for the rats, and for mice, just to be aware, it's the 2 blocks. And then we need to replenish 1 to 2 days after the initial bait placement. And you'll see as we look at take and how palatable it is that this is essential. And then control is possible after day 7. So 7 blocks, inspect 1 to 2 days later, 7 days for control, 7-2-7. So this quick control, this speed baiting, if you like, is, it's because cilantro, it's highly effective now. So, but to do this, we need this, remember I was on about this partnership, this unique combination between the palatability of the bait matrix and the fast action of the cholecalciferol. And we have this stop feeding effect, so that's why we need the high palatability. But this stop feeding effect means that they stop feeding on the bait, and then it then reduces the control time for the infestation, because after they stop feeding, then the next level I mentioned earlier on, the next hierarchical level in an infestation, it leaves the bait free for them to feed on. But they can only feed on that if you've then replenished. If the first hierarchy, the first wave of rats that feed on the cilantro, if they've eaten all the cilantro, then the second level come, the other rats come, and there's nothing on mice, and there's nothing there for them, then you won't get control. But by using this bait matrix with cilantro and the new baiting procedure, this 1 to 2 days later, then we ensure that each rodent, there's enough bait there for them to consume a lethal dose. And then we get this 100% control in as few as 7 days. And this is just an infographic now to just represent what I was saying. So we have, if we think of like the dominant rats at the top or mice, and then the subdominants, and then the non-dominants, just to keep it simple, we've just done them three. So for the first 1 to 2 days, the dominants feed. And then they're back in their nest burrows. They could be either dead or dying after they've eaten their lethal dose. Then the next wave, they'll feed maybe days 2, 3, 4, and then they're into the burrows. And then the next wave feed, they're on days 5 and 6. So by day 7, if there's enough bait available, then all the rats or mice would have eaten a lethal dose, and then we get this 100% control. So on day 1, we want to bait. We want to replenish on days two or three. Then on day seven, we go back then and replenish, and then we do every 7 days. So it's day one, then two or three, so up to 2 days later, day seven, and then every 7 days after that. And this is all possible, this quick turnaround, like I say, because of this stop feeding effect after 1 day from eating a lethal dose. What this means is that if we can control quicker with cilantro, so the 7 days instead of the 21 days that's typical of a anticoagulant, then we have, if we control three times quicker, then we've got less grain eaten, less alternative food eaten, uncontaminated, and less damage done, less disease spread. And then also, so that makes the customer happier, and also it saves the pest controllers time. So this that's why with compared to anticoagulants, we can reduce the damage caused by the rodents. And they don't need to, they won't be having multiple feeds that because of the stop feeding effect. So we're more efficient in that way as well. And this again, a nice infographic to explain what I was saying. So one, after the first day, after they've eaten a lethal dose, they have this stop feeding effect. So you need less bait. They won't keep feeding and feeding. The rodents will stop feeding and contaminating, and also then stop the spread of disease. So while cilantro can't overcome neophobia because it's a natural defence behaviour, because it's so highly palatable, because it smells of food that they're used to, this 99% food grade, human food grade ingredients that they recognise the smell of, because it's so highly palatable and so appealing, then when they come across it, then there is like kind of it helps to overcome this neophobic response, but it'll still be there. But the neophobic response that is the problem is it to the bait boxes. Once we have the bait boxes in place, and the particularly the rats are used to going in the bait boxes, then we find that the control with the next subject I want to cover is resistance management. For the resistance management with cilantro, we have like a two-pronged attack. So firstly, that resistance to cholecalciferol and hence to cilantro is highly likely to develop. And this is because cholecalciferol is an essential kind of pro-hormone in mammals. And we need it, if you remember what I mentioned earlier, we need it for this, the control, the metabolic control of the calcium levels. So for a rodent to be resistant to cholecalciferol, they would have to be able to tolerate high levels of calcium in their blood. And we know that high changes in the calcium level of 10 to 15% is fatal. So that's why it's highly unlikely to develop. So that's the first kind of prong that we have. This it's essential for, it's key to many physiological processes. And the second prong is that it's effective against all rats and mice that are resistant to anticoagulants. And to just, this slide just shows some of the data that we have on anticoagulant resistant rats. If you remember when we were looking at pen trials with wild derived mice, we put up data on anticoagulant resistant mice with that. So this shows you with the anticoagulant resistant brown rats. So these are choice tests, and we have Wistar rats, which are just normal susceptible rats. Then we have the Welch, which are resistant to first generations, Hampshire, resistant to first generations and tolerant to diphenicum and bromodilone. And the last one we call Berkshire. So they're resistant to all first generation anticoagulants and also resistant to diphenicum and bromodilone. So as we go down that list, our rats are becoming more and more resistant to anticoagulants. And in brackets for each one is the mutation that they are. So we tested it against male and females in our choice feeding, do you remember, where they can eat cilantro or a controlled diet, and this is the day one palatability. And now you can see why, from the data we've presented, we only do day one palatability, because after that the stop feeding effect kicks in. So that's why all our data is based on day one. And we can see we have 100% mortality and deaths by day three or day four for all those. There's just one Welch rat that survived, and that's because it didn't eat quite enough to die. So this data shows that against anticoagulant susceptible and resistant brown rats, cilantro is palatable, because look how high the palatability ratios are. Like I say, if you remember from our early slides, one is reasonable and two is good, and we've got again ones ranging from 4, 3, 20. Okay. To show how important resistance is in your country, you can go on the Rodenticide Resistant Action Committee website, the RERAC, and you can locate the your country and find a map. So this is the map of Denmark, which is the country I'm presenting to, and we can see the resistance scale here. So dark red is the higher levels of resistance, and then we have yellows, which are the kind of the lower levels. And we can see there's quite a lot of resistance, as you probably already know. And in all of these areas, Salontra would be highly effective because remember the two-pronged attack, resistance is highly unlikely to develop and it kills all anticoagulant resistant rats and mice. And this is just a nice, again, infographic just to show if we have an infestation with both anticoagulant susceptible, the pale grey ones, and anticoagulant resistant, the dark grey ones, and we treat with an anticoagulant to which they're resistant to, and then you do this numerous times, what you're going to end up with, the survivors are just going to be all resistant. Where if you treat the same infestation with Salontra, then you kill both the susceptible and the resistant, and therefore breaking this cycle of resistance. And if we remember, that was one of our four key claims for features, key features and benefits. So the next one is the toxicological profile. Here it's just for information, we have the LD50, so the lethal dose to kill 50%, or for each individual to stand a 50% chance of dying, going across each of the active ingredients for both the target species, rats and mice, and then the non-targets. So this is just for information. This is the same, comparing cholecalciferol with a non-anticoagulant alpha coagulase, just for information. So this is now, that was just primary toxicity data. This is now secondary toxicity data that we have on cholecalciferol. So we have, looking at the first line, rats were fed with a cholecalciferol bait, and then these dead rats were fed to dogs for 14 days. Then the next study was possums were fed cholecalciferol, and then these dead possums were fed to dogs. The third study was possums, which were then fed to cats. And then the fourth study was rats were fed cholecalciferol, and these were then fed to ferrets. And if we look on the right-hand column, We can see that for each of these four studies, there were no clinical signs of toxicosis. So by that we mean no clinical sign of poisoning and no deaths. So no signs of poisoning and no deaths. Okay. The next topic is to cover the environmental profile. The environmental profile for Soolantra is, if you remember from the, again, the key claims and benefits, is that it balances performance and environmental impact. We have, it's not bioaccumulative, it's not persistent in the environment, and in studies on birds, that's quails and mallards, have shown that birds are 50% less sensitive to cholecalciferol than rats are. So that's our balance. The next topic we want to cover is safety measures. So we produce this advice on treatment, emergency treatment of cholecalciferol poisoning for veterinarians. So it's not a marketing tool, and it will be for veterinarians only. But we have produced that. And the last section is global testimonials. I mentioned that this was a global product, so I just want to go through a little bit on that. This is, Soolantra was first registered for emergency use in Australia in 2015. And here you can see globally the dark blue spots, that's where we have registration. And then if we focus on Europe, we can see the grey areas, areas where it's authorised within Europe. So that just gives you an idea of how global our product is. So we have it from everywhere, from Russia to America and in between. So just a few testimonials. So the first study was a swine farm in Australia, and this was from Jonathan Doubleday, director of CCD Animal Health, and he said, unlike other rodenticides that they have used, rats continue to enter the bait stations and consume Soolantra, and he thinks it's due to the fact-acting nature of the active, as well as its high palatability. The second study was at this student house, which I did put up the results of in one of our examples in Liverpool City, where we got 100% control with 7 days of baiting. Again, this was in bait boxes, and we found that, the quote was from Paul Savon, which is the director of Instant Pest Solutions UK that actually undertook the trial with us. And he said, we found Soolantra rodent bait to be very quick in gaining control of the rats, especially considering that we had issues with waste bins and food spillages. The third study was agricultural, or case study that I just want to mention, is agricultural building in France, where they had 100% control after 11 days of baiting. And this is the one, do you remember from the graphs, where they took 11 days to overcome neophobia to the bait boxes. And what the trialist here was, which was Aurelian, from who is the project manager at Izzy Innovation, and he said the consumption at the beginning, so the consumption of Soolantra, that is, at the beginning of the baiting period, was lower than kind of the at the end of the pre-baiting phase. So it's lower than the monitoring. So when at day 11 of the monitoring, the pre-treatment monitoring, it was 2175 grams a day. And the first day of Soolantra treatment, it was 1818 grams a day. So although it's less, that's about 80% of the pre-census. So I think for something new in an environment where it's neophobia, I think that's really good. So the consumption at the beginning of the baiting period was lower than that of the end of the pre-baiting phase, 2,175 grams at the end of the monitoring period, and 1,818 at the beginning of the treatment. This could be expected because the rats were very familiar with the bait station, but unfamiliar with the Soolantra. So again, I think good testimonial. The fourth testimonial was in Urban in Lyon in France, and we got 100% control with 11 days of baiting. And again, there was this neophobia to bait boxes, but this only took 4 days to overcome. And I think in my experience, urban neophobia is significantly less than rural generally. I know rats can never be summed up in just one, they do this, they do that, but just generally in my experience. And this runs from Gilles Kugler at Rentegil, and he said about Soolantra, exceptional palatability of the product. And if you look on the photograph on the right hand side, you can see that this is after, remember I said you have to come back to replenish 1 to 2 days after initial bait placement, and then every day 7, 14, 21. And we have here, this is what one of the baiting points looked like after 24 hours. So of the 7 blocks placed, there was only one left. And you can see the other 6 wrappers are remaining on the rod. So this is the rod removed from the bait box. So this is why you have to replenish 1 to 2 days later. Because when our second hierarchy, our second wave of rats come to feed, there isn't enough there now for them to eat a lethal dose. So that nicely demonstrates my point. And the last testimonial that I want to mention is it was from a meat production in Russia where they obtained control after only 3 weeks. So I'm not sure, it was all in bait boxes. You can see the photograph there. I'm not sure if there was neophobia to the bait boxes, if they did anything about it. So all I know is from baiting to control, it was 3 weeks, start to finish. And Soolantra showed extraordinary results, fantastic success. And that was from our country sales manager from Speciality Solutions in Russia. So that was his highly kind of praising view of the performance of Soolantra. So with everything I've gone through now, this is the final slide in this presentation. I hope if I go back to the key features and benefits that I've mentioned, I hope you can see how we have the data and how we've worked at obtaining the data to support our 4 key claims. So rodent free in as few as 7 days, again, that's this mode of action and the high palatability, this partnership between the two means that that is possible, but you need the high palatability if they have to eat enough within 1 day, 1.5 days, 2 days to have ingested the lethal dose. Stops the waste of resource because they have this stop feeding effect, so it stops them overeating, consuming multiple lethal doses. And then it also means that they're not contaminating and feeding and destroying the environment that they're in. Balancing performance and environmental impact. If you remember that infographic that shows the scales. So cholecalciferol, the active in Soolantra, is neither persistent in the environment nor bioaccumulative, and it's readily metabolized by rodents. it breaks the cycle of resistance. Remember that two-pronged attack? It kills all anticoagulant resistant rats and mice, and resistance to cholecalciferol is highly likely to develop. So the future, so the development of future resistance is considered highly unlikely. And that, like I said, I just want to end on our key features and benefits. So thank you very much for listening.